Welcome, welcome to the first Beta Break of 2018. Glad you are here. It will be about animals in the lab, of course, as you all know. We started experimenting on animals way back when we just wanted to know more about the human body. The Greeks weren't allowed to cut open humans, so they cut open animals. And Descartes thought animals were just machines, so he just cut them open while they were alive. Since then, we have come a long way, and we have rules and ethics, and we don't do that stuff anymore. Not like that. So we have two guests. Gert Vlik, could you tell us something about yourself?
It works. It's okay, yeah. Yeah. So my name is Gert Vlik.
A little closer?
A little bit closer. I'm a professor of animal physiology at the Radboud University in Nijmegen. My expertise or specialization is in two fields of physiology. First of all, stress physiology of fish in particular, in the broader sense, so the endocrinology of how fish deal with stressful conditions. And the other one is related, but it's bone physiology. How can we use fish as models for questions related, for instance, to osteoporosis? That's in short what I'm doing right now. If you want to know more,
yes,
you have to ask all the questions.
And Ellen, what is your specialty?
My specialty is bioethics. I graduated 25 years ago here at the biology faculty. Then in the days was called Annashoeve, and these buildings were not here. So I did animal experiments myself, but then I continued my career as a philosopher, and I did a PhD on the genetically engineered mouse, which in my opinion is the biotech pioneer. And I think most relevant for this session is that I was a member of the animal experimentation committee of the Dutch Cancer Institute for, I think, about 7-8 years, something like that. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. One more announcement. This is of course, the Beta Break, so if you want to ask any questions, that's cool. You can walk over to Fabio over there, and you can tell him your question, and he will find the right moment to ask it. And without further ado, let's start the discussion. So, to start, Ellen, I'm going to ask you, why do we use animals for science?
I think very clearly because there are many of experiments that we would never ever do on a human being. We want to know things about physiology, the development of diseases, basic understanding of how our body works, and in order to really understand what goes in there, the processes you need to do an experiment, and the most of these you will never ever do on a human being. So we search for alternatives, models for human beings, and these are animals. So we use animals because they look so much like us, but we can use them because they're not us.
Yes, so that's like a paradox, you would say.
Oh, okay, yeah, I refer to this as a laboratory animal paradox. So that's weird that you use an animal because it's not us, and you use it because it looks so much like us. That's weird, that's a paradox.
And Gert, what do you think we would not know without the use of animals in science? What has the use of laboratory animals brought us as a society?
There's two aspects in my perspective. One is the complexity of an intact organism. And even though we have cell systems, tubes, and organoids nowadays, you will never reach at this very moment the complexity of an intact organism. So that's a good reason under certain conditions to study maybe an intact animal as an experimental animal. The other one which I as a physiologist also find important is that we should be able to do fundamental research. We are, in general, rather focused on the human being. Lots of money are spent on research on humans. But we are only one species with maybe three subspecies. And if we are going to talk about fish, just to give you an impression, there's 35,000 species of fish, of which we know very little. And it's my curiosity, my interest in how things are working and how have animals adapted to the niches where you find them. You need to look inside the animal to better understand them. So that's my drive to do experimental work with animals and to offer them when really necessary.
Okay. And to give us an idea, how would you describe the life of an animal, Gert?
A live animal is an animal that can function more or less intact, preferably in its natural environment. So we do a lot of studies just observing animals. And you can learn a lot.
I meant like, how do you, how is the life of an animal, like, is it good or is it bad when...
In the laboratory, you mean?
In the laboratory, yeah.
Depends. My attitude is that we should study an animal with a view on where the animal is coming from. So if you take a fish or a mouse, you should know, is this a social animal? What are the natural needs of the animal? And try to offer that in a natural, in a setting, in a laboratory. Because if you don't, you will stress the animal to some extent, and that may confound your experimental data.
Yes. Okay. So,
Yes. Alan, in our first conversation, you told us about the BCPR, the Dutch Primate Research Institute. You can't see it, but on the televisions, there are two images of the BCPR. One was around 20 years ago when it was very closed and a television crew went inside. And the second is of how it is today. I think you can all see it. How does this represent the changes in the past 20 years in laboratory animals?
Well, I think what you see over here is that the changes are incredible. I mean, in the times I went to university, it was a very closed topic. We didn't discuss. Scientists didn't feel comfortable talking about their laboratory animals, so they were kept in a very secretive manner, like the BCRP in Rijswijk. Nobody knew that there were monkeys there. It was chimps used for HIV studies. And what you see here on this photograph is Willy Bort Verquin. He is he's like pau net avant la lettre. And he was tipped off to go there with the camera because then he could have some shocking images about animal experiments. But what happened? He went there. They went there in the night and they had to climb over the fences. And they had no idea what they were, what would happen. But when they saw these animals in these cages, the camera crew started crying, I heard. And then the images were on television, and then a lot of debate was about these animal experiments with chimps. So there were questions asked in the Dutch government, and so they changed everything. So if you go there now, it looks like housing facilities of Stichting Aap. I mean, they have nice cages, they're taken well care of, and I think these two images kind of reflect the huge revolution that has taken place the past years, if we talk about the care of these animals.
Well, Gert, you've worked for a very long time with fish, I've heard. Have you changed your ways in how you work with them, fish?
Yes and no. As I just said, 35,000 species of fish means as many more or less niches that you have to consider. What can you do? Well, you can take care, for instance, in housing fish that prefer to shoal to keep larger groups of animals together. Some fish like to be alone. You can keep those solitary if you want, but you should know the eco-physiology of the fish to house them properly. And then, of course, all conditions relating to quality of the housing, the husbandry, are important. That means water quality, water quantity, free space, available free space, feeding, light regimens, etc., etc. Whatever you can think of is considered nowadays in our husbandry of fish, because we know from stress research we do, we measure hormones like cortisol, adrenaline in fish, and we know that some fish and some are more sensitive than others to changing conditions will show stress responses similar to yours. If I kick you and make a painful event, similar things happen in fish, and you have to be aware of that. And some fish, a carp is a very resistant, strong fish that can easily survive handling and transportation. a trout is a different story. It's a very sensitive and very nervous type of fish where you have to take other measures. And that should always be kept in mind when you work with fish. The nowadays number one model in animal experimentation is the zebrafish. That is a sturdy fish related to carp. It's a cyprinid. And everybody knows it's a very convenient model to work with. Still, you have to understand the animal to deal properly with its husbandry. I can tell a lot about that, but maybe specific questions will come later. Yeah.
Okay. So you say you work a lot with fish, and you studied pain as well in fish. So yes. I was wondering how you can measure pain in an animal.
That can be done at several levels. If we go from ultrastructural level, if we cut a fin clip, we clip the fins from a fish maybe for genotyping, what is a practice done everywhere in the world, you can fix the part that you clip. You can extract the DNA, of course, for genotyping, but you can also fix it for electron microscopy. And in those fin clips, we see A, delta, and C fibers, and those are the neural pathways for acute and chronic pain. So those are present even in the very tips of the fins of fish. That is a first morphological bit of evidence that you have a circuitry for nociceptive perception. The second thing, you can look, of course, at all kinds of neurotransmitters that we know from our studies on human beings are involved in pain perception, GTRP and so on. All these known systems are present in fish. The ultimate thing, maybe I skip a few levels, you can look at behavior. And if you give a fish, say, a painful event or a nociceptive stimulus, you can modulate learned behavior. So we train fish to do something they've never done before. That's a new behavior. And we see that all kinds of treatments that are nasty, say in a general sense, that they will influence that kind of behavior. So modulation of a learned behavior is an indication that there is awareness in the fish and that the stressful stimulus that you give is indeed stressful for the animal. And that is a situation very similar to what you do with rats or mice or even human beings.
Okay, so you say they're also aware of their surroundings as well then?
Absolutely, and I can give many examples. I'll give you one. A stickleback makes a nest and makes a territory around the nest. The female puts the eggs in the nest, the male fertilizes them. The female is kicked out and then the territory is defended. If there is an intruder, the stickleback will challenge the intruder and chase it for huge distances, relatively spoken, including, travels that take maybe even minutes before the animal returns. So if the animal would have no memory and not a learned environment, it would lose its nest and there would be no sticklebacks nowadays. So that's just one example, and we can give many, many more of these examples. Fish can learn very well, have good memory. The only difficult thing is that you have to know how to look at a fish to understand its very complex behavior. But that is the big problem, because the fish lives in another medium, which makes a big distance between us and fish. If you see behavior of a cat and you have the furry aspect of a cat or a mouse, that's one of the, believe it or not, one of the big differences with fish, because people say, well, it's slippery, it's cold-blooded, which is nonsense, it's an ectotherm, so it's as warm as the water where it's swimming, it has no expression, and all these things, there's too many fish to understand for many people. That all makes it easy to say, well, we don't have to include the fish in our moral cycle, or circle, I should say. While if you look from an evolutionary point of view at fish, we as we sit here, share with fish an ancestor, evolutionarily spoken. So our bouwplan, our physiology, has roots that we share with fish. And in fact, all our physiology has been, in principle, been developed in fish. So the success of us is due to the success of fish. So that's okay. Where I am.
So, Alan, as a philosopher, I wonder then, how much can you compare the pain in an animal to the pain in a human? Is it possible to put those in the same perspective?
Well, of course, you can never know what an animal feels, but you can also never know what somebody else feels. But you can use your imagination. And if you see a physical response that's described by my neighbor, then there probably will be some pain involved. The animal doesn't like it. I mean, it's turning away. So I think it's only reasonable to suggest that there is pain sensation, and you should take that into consideration. But I want to ask you something else, because 25 years ago, when I was a student, I worked with goldfish. And I'd like to know whether the types of experiments that I was doing in those days, if that would be possible today. I worked with goldfish and I studied the retina of the fish, so the visual cortex and the retina. I'm a neurobiologist. So what we did, there were two types of experiments. One I was not involved, but they put the goldfish in a stereotact, so it was fixed. And then they removed the skull from the fish, and then they put in the measuring electrodes, and then they offered a visual stimulus on a television screen, and they were measuring the activity in the visual cortex, which was always very blurry, and there was no way they could say anything about that. And then at the end of the day, they put some, I thought it was chewing gum on its head, and they put it back in the fish tank, and next day they would get it out again and put it back in. That's one of the experiments. And the other one, I was involved. We just collected the eyes, and then half blinded, we put the fish back. And I measured the cells in the retina from those fish. And they were all dying of certain diseases. And they also had a collection of trouts that were no longer in experiments and just lived in a water tank. Do you think what I describe now is still possible nowadays?
to some extent, but for sure.
I was shocked. I quit that internship. That, I left.
You don't maybe tell the whole story. Did you anesthetize the fish?
What's that? No.
Giving them anesthesia,
no.
Like they give to you when you go on the surgery table.
No, I had a feeling that the people I worked with, they felt that fish
was
didn't...
Was not necessary at that
no,
time.
No, they didn't scream. Yeah.
That's right. Well, that is a misunderstanding, by the way. Many fish make noises and vocalizations, but we cannot hear it. That's the problem again. But nowadays, also in our practice at the university hospital, there is a lot of ciliopathies that we study in zebrafish,
yeah.
And where we also look at retinopathies and so on and so on. The law on animal experimentation prescribes that you anesthetize a fish as you do with a rat or a mouse or a human being. So if that practice was lost or not done in your times, then it was a very bad period for the fish, I can tell you.
Yeah, but this is also an answer to your question. Did things change? I think change. There were many changes. But in those days, the Animal Experimentation Committee was not yet fully...
No, fish were not a matter of discussion at that time. They
but
are
then
now.
Did they were not part of the law? As a
no, not at no. That time, no. But now they are.
Yeah, so that's
and the things that you describe, like putting chewing gum or whatever on the brain case, there is in fish remarkable resilience to all kinds of treatments, and there is regeneration capacities. I mentioned the fin clipping. Fish, if I clip your arm too bad, it won't regrow. A fish fin will regrow in a fortnight.
Uh-huh.
And you cannot even tell that you clipped the fin. So that is a peculiar property of fish that has gone lost when animals moved from water to terrestrial niches.
Mm-hmm.
that's where you are.
Sorry, I have a question from the public here.
Ah.
Yeah, I was wondering, like, didn't they know they had pain and therefore no regulation and any laws about it, or like, didn't they care?
To be honest, they didn't care. It was a shocking experience, because it was one of my first internships. They had very cool electrophysiology equipment, but the system we were measuring was very, very complex. So it was a 5-layer of cells, and you only measured one layer with many number of feedback mechanisms. The computers that we used at that time, they were not fast enough. They had, didn't have the same speed as the recording apparatus. So it was very hard to make any sense of the signals that were measured. And according to me, the only thing I saw on the screen was 50 hertz. So the field potential.
Yeah.
And my colleagues, the PhDs that worked there, looked at, seemed to me rather depressed because they spent their whole day in a dark room because there was no daylight because we were studying the retina. You had to do it in the dark. The only light there was a red light. There was no reflection at all. They didn't discuss the animals. I noticed that the animals were ill. They were dying. So I bought a book about fish diseases and I removed some of the infectious tissue and looked at it through a microscope and find out what kind of disease there was, and then I left. But there was no reflection at all. So in that sense, I'm really happy that something's changed.
I think it is a little bit shortcut to say that people didn't care, simply.
No, in that group, I never heard anyone talk about it.
No, but people did not care because they did not know.
Yeah, and, but and that's naive.
That's naive, but the situation has changed, of course. People nowadays know because we start to discuss things like, well, are you aware of the fact that the fish is a vertebrate animal like you are, and that you need considerations similar to your considerations on pain and stress and so on and so on.
Yeah, so that's a good thing.
All right, you've said how much the rules change it, and how nowadays such practice can't be done. So how are actually the rules for lab animals? If nowadays you want to do an experiment, how does that work?
On a philosophical level, I would say you have to come up with very, very good arguments. You have to explain why you believe that the experiments you are planning to do are useful. What is the benefit to society or the benefit for science? And you have to come up with arguments. So what you do, in fact, is you fill in a form with a number of questions that will guide you through a thinking process. You have to explain what is the potential outcome of your experiments, what is the goal of your experiment, why you need these animals and not other animals, or why you is there an alternative model. You have to explain how you take care of the animals, anesthesia, pain release. And you have to give it a good thought, and the number of animals, how you treat the animals.
So is there anything in the law that says you can't do this, or is anything possible, but you have to get it through a committee?
It starts with you're not allowed to do unless. So you have to come up with very good arguments. And one of these arguments, for example, there's no other way of achieving this goal. And that's a tricky one, because there are many ways to achieve a goal depending on the level of your goal description. For example, if I say I want to do something about lung cancer, I really want to reduce suffering from lung cancer, I can do two things. I can do an animal experiment that helps me understand lung cancer and come up with a treatment, or I start an anti-smoking campaign, which is much cheaper and far more effective. So that would be a good alternative. But, yeah.
Okay.
It's difficult.
But there's also lung cancer without smoking.
Yeah.
So I was also wondering, so what the rules are based on. Are they based on popular opinion, or are they based on science, like do animals feel pain and these animals don't? Because the law applies to vertebrates, but right now in my own experiments for a course I have, we are killing hundreds of, say, elegans, worms. So why is that allowed, and why am I not allowed to use vertebrates? How large is the difference, Gert?
Well, I think it's a matter of complexity of organization and behavior that you can see in an animal. Conclusions on what can be done and cannot be done require consideration from the ecophysiology of the animal and the likelihood that you give discomfort to the animal. And when it comes to, say, the division between vertebrates and invertebrates, so vertebrates from fish to human beings on the one side and the invertebrates on the other side, there's a few considerations in the complexity of the nervous system. And are there perceptive mechanisms for, say, nociceptive signals, so bad things that happen in your environment? And then, yeah, you should see whether the animal gives, an advantageous response in from an evolutionary point of view, so an acclimation or an adaptation-based response. And it is up to the researcher to interpret that response as, should I take measures or not to avoid painful or bad conditions for that animal? And I think with a worm or a fly, people are easily saying, well, what the heck, numbers count, and the distance between us and those animals. And my point of view is that we maybe should always have a common sense opinion on what's going on if you kill an animal for whatsoever reasons. And please, let's get started with the vertebrates, because that's where we are sure that problems arise. Nociceptive signals are perceived. So, and you see that systems in the brains are activated during nociceptive experiences. Systems that are similar to our, for instance, prefrontal cortex, amygdala, and hippocampus. So there you are sure. In a C. elegans, I don't think there is a pain perception or there is suffering in a C. elegans. Yes, there is perception of stimuli from the outside world. And how do you interpret that? Is it giving a reflex in the animal? And how do we interpret that? That's the question where you should start and discuss with people. And of course, it's not unless you can show that you need to do an experiment, that would be the starting point for me. If you do not know how painful or nociceptive stimuli are interfering with the organism, you should take all measures that you can take.
Okay.
To avoid them. Yep.
Ellen, would you like to comment?
Yeah, I would like to give an alternative answer to the same question. What is the basic rationale behind this legislation? Is that public opinion or is it science? I think it is a combination of both, and it should be a combination of both. The part of the public, we live in a democracy, and there is a growing objection against animal experimentation for the wider public. And we live in a democracy. If the Dutch people say at a certain moment, we don't want animal experiments anymore, then I'm very sorry for you, but then that's the end. But we are not there. And there are also scientific arguments. And I think the public should be informed by science and the other way around. And I think the most important thing about this legislation and talk about animal experiments is that both scientists as the public are being heard in the law. So I understood my task in the Animal Experimentation Committee as the voice of the people. Because I'm a medical biologist and I can talk along with the scientists, but the people on the Dutch public might have another opinion because they have another idea about life, about animals, about disease and responsibilities, and they should be heard as well. And the challenge is to translate the public voice into something that you can do in an ethical committee. So both.
So what would be your what would be required from a scientist for you to approve an experiment?
I would allow a scientist to do experiments when I truly believe the story behind the experiment. If he can really explain to me why it is important that we do this experiment. And I would never say that it's necessary because I don't believe in necessity. There's always another way to do it, but it should be a sound story and a good story, and there should be value involved. So there's value created in terms of knowledge or new medicine. I don't say that only applied research is valuable. I think fundamental research is also valuable, but you should really think about it very well. Yeah.
I have to interrupt. I have two questions from the public.
Go ahead. Oh, good afternoon. I would like to go shortly back to the improvements we've made over the past 25 years. Because we kind of get the idea that now all animals being used are treated in a good and almost humane way, being treated as we are during surgery and stuff. But not only have indeed regulations gone improved, also the number of animals used have grown to millions of animals on a yearly basis, and a lot of the experiments being done require the animals to experience pain or be in a bad situation, either physically or psychologically induced. So how do we feel about, in my opinion, the a bigger part of experiments that are not humane by a definition?
Let me see what I understood you correctly. I'm going to summarize what you told. I understood that you're saying there are the number of animals that are being used are is increased over the years. Yeah? Is that true? Yeah? Yeah, there's sitting somebody behind you that knows a lot about animals. And the other thing you're suggesting that the type of experiments is with more discomfort, so they're more horrible. Yeah, that would be that would for me that would be an issue because I would really, as an experimenter, would really feel horrible about doing these experiments. So it's not only stressful for the animal; it's also very stressful for the experimenter, for the scientist. I think this is problematic. I don't think you really need to have a very, very good reason. If you know that these animals suffer visibly and you know this, then you really have to have very, very good reasons. And I think not all of these experiments would pass my test of importance. What do you think?
I think two answers. First of all, the number of experiments done with experimental animals is certainly increasing. Just look at the correlation there will be with publication output. But that, say, the number of animals used and the questions that we can ask, and let's not be biased too much about what happens here in northwestern Europe. Have a look at what happens in India and in China if you want to see where the increase is really, really exponential. But that's maybe another question. I think the number and quantity of experiments done not necessarily or not at all needs to have a correlation with the severity of the experiments. And I would say, at least in environments like here in Holland and in Western Europe, where there is a strict control by ethical committees, on average, the discomfort given to animals will be towards the better end of the scope of the division of how you interpret painful conditions or stressful conditions for the animals. And the awareness is rising in researchers that if you stress an animal in advance, at the starting point of your experiments, unnecessarily so, you have a serious confounder. If I stress a fish and there is a rise in adrenaline and cortisol hormones that act on every cell in the body of the animal, then you better know what you're doing. So understand basic conditions before you start an experiment. And that is where ethical committees in the Netherlands at least, and but also in Belgium and Europe in general, have a critical view on what can be done, what should be done, and where the humane endpoints are.
Okay, I think it's clear. Do we have time for one more question, or do we need to go?
Go ahead.
Okay, this is about the discussion whether rules should be based on public opinion or scientific community.
Okay, I had a question about including the opinion of the general public, because a lot of times when I talk to people outside of life science, they have a really not a good image about what's happening with lab on animals and testing on animals. And then they often do have a really strong opinion while it's not based on facts. And I think the public opinion should be included, but it should be from well-informed people. So do you think it's fair to include the general public when they're not informed and therefore cannot have good judgment, in my opinion?
Yeah, I think it's very important that you inform better. I think it's really problematic that people don't understand what you're doing. And I've been hearing this for 25 years. I've met researchers that didn't dare, they were afraid to talk about their work because they were so afraid of negative responses that they simply didn't talk about it. Well, if you keep up this, they don't understand what I'm doing attitude, they will never be empathetic for you. So that is an issue, and I think there should be better info. But I think basically, if you ask people bottom down on the level of values and important things, that they're not necessarily against animal experimentation. Usually what people say, I don't want animal experiments for cosmetics. And I always say, yeah, but oh, that's forbidden in the Netherlands for over 30 years, so that's not what it's about. And then if you ask them for what research questions it should be allowed, and when you talk about cancer research, most people say, okay, under one condition, that you take care well, that you take good care of your animals. But that's basically, you don't have to be afraid of the public opinion. Be honest, and most people have sound ideas about, if they're well informed, about where the boundaries are. And they're just like you. Yeah, me.
There's a huge task for the universities and educational systems in general to educate the layman public. Biology, even for researchers, is becoming increasingly complex and difficult to understand. Go into a topic in genetics and you lose your way very quickly unless you are really involved. It's my experience that the programs that we run in Nijmegen, our curricula, for instance, include courses where we teach our students for social awareness. So what are you doing with our tax money? What is your research? And how are you going to translate this to society? we have other activities in Nijmegen where on occasions, festive occasions, the professors take a bike and go to primary schools and give 2 hours lectures to pupils from 5 to 10 years old and things like that. I think it is extremely important that we see that we are an elite, and I don't want to make this ivory tower discussion, that we are an elite with a responsibility to give our knowledge to the layman public and try to explain as well as possible what we are doing and why we are doing. And this meeting is an example of how you can reach a broader public. Excellent. And that should be done more and more and more. And I think universities and curricula committees at our universities should spend more time on how we export our knowledge to everybody around you. If I say, when I started my research on fish and stress, my children were at school, and then the children asked, what is your father doing? Well, he's studying, he's a biologist, so he's in an animal farm. No, he's at university. And then he's studying fish. What? Is he working in the zoo in Arnhem or wherever in Artis in the aquarium? No, he studies fish. What is he studying on fish? Stress. And then the laughter was complete. But nowadays, in a series of programs that we've run with studies on fish, people are becoming aware of the fact that fish can be stressed. And everybody who has taken time to look at a fish knows that some fish, if you bump the glass of the aquarium, they will jump in a corner and never appear again. Things like that. And we need to improve and further improve the knowledge of the layman public about this kind of thing. Whether it's a fish or a mouse, the same.
Thank you for the good questions. So, Ellen, when we talked earlier, you mentioned that many of the animal experiments performed are not reproducible. And you were quite passionate about that. So I want to ask you, what causes this problem?
Yeah, no, well, one of the major arguments of the anti-animal experiment activists is that most of the research being done on animals is not useful. And I think they have an argument. A few years ago, there was a series of articles in Nature. And what they did, they tried to reproduce the experiments in cancer research, and they focused on the 50 most influential studies, and they tried to reproduce these experiments. In the philosophy of science, reproducibility is very, very important, but nobody ever does it. Nobody will ever do an experiment that somebody else already did. I mean, that's not interesting. Okay, but it was very hard to reproduce these experiments. In fact, the numbers are shocking. I don't have them in my mind, but I think only 15% of the experiments were able to reproduce. So in fact, you could say that maybe not all the research we are doing and the results that are published are that useful if we cannot even reproduce it. So this argument of my research is very, very important. So I think it's very important that the quality of your research is good. And there are some questions about that. I think if it's published in Nature, that's a serious issue.
But do you have any idea what might have caused this unreproducibility in those experiments?
Yeah, I think that there is something in science going on at this moment, that there is so much pressure on publication that there are prefers incentives on researchers to publish. So maybe they not all the research that is being conducted is as objective and sound as it should be. And I have some doubts about the peer review and the peer review between colleagues. Do scientists openly communicate about their difficulties in the lab, and don't they feel too much pressure to publish and therefore tend to be less careful about...
How do you think about this?
Yes, I think one of the basic problems in reproducing results is that we all too often do not understand the resolution of the outcome of our experiments, and that is a matter of making proper questions at the start of your experiment and describe them as good as possible. So the resolution of your outcome, and I could give an example maybe. If you look at many, many, many questions in cell biology, for instance, if you look at the evolution, there's life forms on Earth 3.5 billion years. 3 billion years of cell evolution, and then, say, 500-600 million years of multicellular life forms like us. Understanding a cell is, and I may refer, for instance, to people that are going to make an artificial cell, I think it is way, way far further away from where we are in understanding systems than anybody thinks so far. The complicatedness of a single cell is already, should be an inhibition on what questions can you ask and what tools do we have to answer these questions? And I think that's where the problem is. Understanding a cell is already a problem, let alone if you're going to look at complex organisms. So,
but how do you explain this to a laboratory animal that, oh, I'm so sorry, the data I achieve from you are so complex that I, in fact, cannot interpret it. But thank you very much for participating in my experiment.
No. I think that is a wrong way of posing the situation.
But that's what the animal activists say. Would say.
Yeah, animal activists will say, don't do any experiments.
Yeah.
Until you say, well, do you use aspirin or whatever? And then they, now I have to reconsider whether there should be done some experiments with animals. Because only, as we said already at the beginning of the discussion, the complexity of an animal cannot be mimicked as yet with organoids or whatever we can come up with. Maybe in future with systems biology, artificial learning machines, and so on, that we come close to and can avoid a lot of experiments on animals, but not at this moment.
It could be an argument to say maybe we should be a little bit more modest about what we can achieve with these animal experiments and be a little bit more selective and put more time into formulating
I have no problems with that.
My final words are the quality of the research. That should be the major... if the quality of the research is... If there's any doubt about the quality, either in the experimental setup, either in the way we interpret the data, then it was a useless sacrifice of animals.
Yeah, but that means put the right question. If you do research on osteoporosis, on bone diseases, which is a major epidemics to come in the near future, what do you know about wind signaling? Is there a single wind signaling pathway? No, there are many. What do we know about them? What do we know about crosstalk? What do we know about bidirectional communication in these systems? Nothing. So ask your question properly and then only start your experiments.
Okay. So you say asking better questions will make for better science. That's, of course, quite logical. But is there also something in the research climate? So you mentioned the publication stress. If I don't like my results, I will do another statistical test on it, and my p-value will be below 0.5. How can we improve such a climate?
I think we should be far more relaxed on what you expect from a PhD. So this ideal of 4A publications, I think somebody should be valued on basis of the work he or she did and the thoughts in it, and not necessarily the results in forms of written papers that nobody will ever read.
Okay, would you agree
and
with
more
that?
More collaboration within groups, so less competition and more collaboration, and I would try to get rid of this pyramidal career model where there's only one at the top and 100 below, so less PhDs and more postdocs, and make far more efficient use of your intelligence and skills and knowledge in your organization. A more people-friendly organization would also be beneficial for the animals, I think.
Well, Gert, you are kind of at the top as the head of the animal physiology at Radboud University. So I've heard when we had our first conversation, I heard you talk a lot about bureaucracy, that for some zebrafish you need to fill in 100 pages. Don't you agree with Ellen and think it should be more relaxed and you should more be able to do what you want to do?
Well, there's many things to say about that. The bureaucracy and that we need half an hectare of wood to describe a single experiment on five zebrafish. That is maybe a non-discussion right now. The basics are, of course, that you want to do an experiment on a vertebrate. Okay. Where it comes to bureaucracy and avoiding bureaucracy, there's many good things going on. For instance, systematic reviews on before you start an experiment. There's lots of tools nowadays, worldwide access to databases on what has been done and does not need to be repeated. That's one thing. I think also access, open access to in repositories like we use in Nijmegen. If you run a PhD project in Nijmegen, all your data are stored in an open access mode, and that can be protected if it's needed for a while. But it means that you can share with, well, many people around you, and that should be more and more be applied in science to avoid unnecessary experiments with animals. Other parts of bureaucracy. This is the Netherlands.
Okay, so I want to move on to the final part. So if you have a question, you can you should stand up now and walk to Fabio, and then we will go on. Ultimately, this discussion also comes down to how do we justify the use of laboratory animals ethically, both in the way of can we see animals as can we do are we superior to animals? And also, how much can we truly learn from animals about humans? So the first question, how do we justify using animals for science ethically, Ellen?
Yeah, that's a difficult one. I would like to refer to the philosopher Peter Singer, who said, well, what we are actually doing is a form of a speciesism. So we it's like a racist, similar to racism, but then towards other species. We feel that we are our own interests of the human species. We think they're more weight than the interest of animals. And that is a position that I think is questionable, and therefore you always have to come up with good arguments. I think I tended over the years to become I'm less easy convinced of, well, we could do that. And I think I think basically it is a problem. I mean, every animal has, in my opinion, the right to be left alone. And any animal that is put in a cage doesn't want to be there. I mean, it didn't choose for itself to be there. The lack of freedom is problematic. But on the other hand, I'm a curious biologist. I want to understand how life works. It's a difficult one.
So you haven't been able to solve that for yourself yet?
No, but I know that the experiments I did when I was a student, I don't think I would do that anymore. But the basic question is, can I look at myself in a mirror when I go to bed and I think about what I'm doing and how can I explain it to my next door girl from 8-10 years old? I think that's a good thing, if you can do that. Yeah,
Gert.
Well, I think we are in a time frame right now where we see a shift in ethical awareness of what's going on with animals and animal experimentation, for the better of the animals in general. I mean, we had a discussion on using monkeys for research. Is it really necessary? Well, there may be still a few, say, biomedical questions that you can only solve with a monkey, with a primate, but that, at least in the Netherlands, that is limited to the extreme, and rightfully so. You made a suggestion that an animal in a cage or in a confined situation is not happy. That's certainly not always the case. So we should always be critical on, is the animal showing proper behavior? Can it show proper behavior? I in the train coming here, I was reading a book on aquaculture, the development of aquaculture in Roman times, where people already knew that if you keep fish for your personal purposes, as food, people were already then aware of the fact that you should control the quality of the bottom of your pond, that you should put in rocks with plants on it to give the animals the right feeling and to prosper in those environments. And I think we can also in aquaria, in our experimental laboratories, we can provide animals with proper environments. I mean, a mouse in a cage is a confinement, but a mouse in nature has also a confinement because it's not traveling between the Netherlands and China, to say it in an extreme way. A mouse can be very happy on a square meter. But provide shelter, provide the right food, water, light conditions as it needs, and burrowing qualities of the environment.
Okay, we have one question.
I have a short question, yes?
Yeah. What do you think about experimenting on humans who otherwise get a death sentence? Like, shouldn't that be an option? Just to test if the human have pain, maybe the animals have too, thereby not doing a test on animals?
Would you ask them? I mean, any experiment that you would do on a human being, I think it's totally irrelevant whether this person is about to die on a. I'm against death sentence, so this is problematic.
More like on a deathbed.
In a deathbed, then if there is informed consent and this person is willing to participate in the research and has good reasons to do so, is well informed. But I need to have a little bit more details about, yeah, what you would do.
Do you feel there are a lot of people with death sentence, like in America, for crimes they indeed did, so with evidence? But I thought maybe those deaths could be useful for the safety of the animals, because humans can talk, they can say, well, it hurts, so don't do it.
The best model is always the human being. Let me be clear about that. But the human being is autonomous, and you cannot do these things unless you want to understand something about...
Human being is the best model of all.
You want to understand human diseases, but maybe for other questions, it's not. No,
we can understand human diseases also in experimental animals quite well. Depends on the gene repertoire that's underlying the disease. And some of them are present in fish even, as they are in you. So
I have one more question before we go to the end.
Yeah, so, okay. So this question is basically you say that you're using animals to either have fundamental research or to understand how human beings work, basically. So my question is, how many of these experiments are actually aimed at improving welfare of the animals? So basically understanding their behavior, their, their attributes to actually help their cause.
If we understand better how, for instance, and I mentioned already in the discussion some time ago, people were laughing at me when I said fish have stress. We know now that understanding how you take care of fish husbandry has enormous implications for aquaculture. At this moment, human consumption of protein depends on fish. 45% fisheries, 55% aquaculture. Aquaculture is the new bioindustry to come. Here we can take actions and take measures to try as much as possible to give the best welfare to the animals. Because eventually, I mean, it's a two-sided question, of course. If you provide the animals with better conditions, productions will go up, and we need that protein. So it is favorable on both sides. Animal welfare first. Take care that you do not give unnecessary discomfort, and at the same time you will improve your productivity. And that is based on scientific fundamental research. Nobody knew about endocrinology of stress in fish until we started that 20 years ago.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so I think we have time for two more questions. So the other question I asked was, how much do we truly learn from animals about humans? Is it more or less than we think of it now as we use them?
Well, you ask a medical biologist. I learned a lot about the way the human bodies work, and I think a large quantity of that knowledge is based on animal research, so I think we learned a lot. Yeah. But I cannot quantify that. Yeah.
If we go back to the single cell and remember the studies of Kandel on aplysia neurons, that's where we learned a lot that we would never have learned from human beings alone, and so on. I think it is important if we just focus on the vertebrates that we realize that we are vertebrates as fish are, and that there is a whole evolution to be studied, fragmented, of course, because we cannot study all, where we can learn, where we have shared gene patterns and gene repertoires that may be at the basis of illnesses or at functioning in general.
Okay, thank you. So our final question, you already answered it a bit. It was about whether the use of organoids and systems biology could replace the animal model, and you already said it's the whole system is too complex, probably. But let's say, hypothetically, in 100 years, we can cure every disease there is. Would we still be using animals?
Depends on whether we still have questions. I'm very much inspired by the idea of the modeler body. So this is a concept developed by an artist, that in the end we can all tissue culture organs from our own cells, and we can endlessly recreate our own body parts. There will be no animals involved. Maybe for the medium we have to grow the cells in, but I think we can surround that. But as long as we have questions about the natural world, we can learn from the animals. But I do think the research methodology will become more sophisticated and less harmful to the animals, I hope.
With my limited comprehension of computer sciences, I'm still optimistic because I think the power of systems biology and the power of computers ever increasing, and we're close to quantum chips and things like that. So we can, at this moment, we cannot really foresee what's going to happen. But I'm optimistic in the sense that if you look, for instance, at one aspect, a disease is a deviation of a certain regulatory pathway, only a small part of the whole system. So yes, it may be very well possible that in future we can mimic a disease as a part of a total concept where one deviation occurs, and then maybe we understand the pathways and can design medication or treatments to treat that disease. So in that aspect, I'm optimistic. I think at this very moment, the complexity is still overwhelming, but the future is yours.
Okay, so we have to round up. I want to thank you both for coming here. It was a good discussion. It
was a pleasure.
And I want to thank the audience for coming here. In February, we'll have a new edition, of course, 21, right? 21 February. It will be about CRISPR-Cas, so it will also be very fascinating. Please come join us then. Thank you.